registers for your runoff, for your bus, etc., and parking. Just say we're going to be back here in the Key Learning Centre on Thursday, the 25th of February, for two sessions, and it's with the Reminiscence Officer at the Museum of Oxford, who will be doing Memories of St. Ebbs. So if you do remember St. Ebbs and would like to share memories and be involved in a project which includes children from St. Ebbs School, do come along. It's Thursday the 25th of February, 11 till 12 and 2 till 3. We'll also be back here on Wednesday the 27th of January at 5:30. For OA's Julian Mumby, who's also a trustee of OPT, for a talk called Newnham in the Oxford Landscape, which is also to coincide with the 300th anniversary of the birth of Capability Brown. So do look out for that. And Thursday, the 18th of February at 5:30 for Malcolm Graham, talking about Oxford and the Great War. Details are in here, so if you want to pick up one of these and you want to remember, do take one of these because it's got the details on. And while you're all here as well, I was going to say, if you aren't a member but are a joiner, do think about becoming a member of Oxford Preservation Trust. We are a charity that relies on support and fundraisers for our conservation work. At the moment, we're trying to find a sustainable future for the painted room to provide greater public access to the wall paintings. We're trying to fundraise to restore the railway swing bridge. We run Oxford Open Doors, we publish the Oxford Heritage Rules books, and your support would be greatly appreciated. If not, we'd be very pleased to see you at any of our events, or if you'd like to get involved as a volunteer, we'd be delighted. Which brings us back to tonight, and the sixth in our Archaeology of the Westgate lectures, which are being run in support of the Westgate archaeological excavation, which has been carried out by Oxford Archaeology, and with thanks to Land Securities, who's made this possible. And I have great pleasure in introducing you to Ben Ford, Senior Project Manager at Oxford Archaeology, to tell you about the really recent and exciting findings at the Westgate.
Good evening, everybody. So this is the last in the talks of the series. We've heard details of lots of aspects about St. Ebbs, the Greyfriars, etc. In the previous five talks, and we'll be putting all six talks up on our website. So if you missed any of those talks, the website address will be at the end of this talk. So, it being the last talk, I'd like to take the opportunity to say thanks to Jane Baldwin. Thank you, Jane, very much for, along with OPT and Debbie Dance, for collaborating with us on setting up these talks and supporting us through the excavations. And thank you to David Radford, the city archaeologist as well, whose idea it was to have these set of talks and got all the speakers together. My name's Ben Ford, and I work with Oxford Archaeology, and I've been directing the excavations at the Westgate. Really, we only really got going in June last year. We did a little bit of work before that, and some of you may have come to the open days, and we had two open days, one to see one of the trenches across the Trillmill Stream, and the other one to see as much of the Greyfriars complex as we could get exposed to the public at any one time, really. So after that second open day, we continued our excavations to the south and exposed a serious amount of more archaeology. So literally, this talk is hot off the shovel, as it were. Some of the slides might be a bit ropey. I was going to put some sketches in, some stuff that I was kind of working on as ideas, but I'm trying to keep it as professional looking as possible. I've tried to choose some of the best images that we've got, but we've got literally thousands of images, and to trawl through them all is going to be impossible. So I hope you'll like them, and they represent some of the highlights so far. And we are still excavating, so starting tomorrow, we're doing underneath the roadway just here. So the bus road It's going round that way. And we're going to be digging under the road. So the excavations are still ongoing. So the plans that I'll be showing you are not complete, and some of the plans don't have some of the stuff we've already excavated on them, because that's still being processed on site over the last few weeks. So it's kind of a little bit ropey in places, and hopefully I'll get an opportunity later in the year to kind of update and do another talk after we've done a bit of analysis as well. So some of the dating etc. might not be exact, but really I just wanted to give you a flavour of some of the highlights. So hopefully I'm going to get this right. So I'm going to take you through, first of all, a little bit about the background, where the site sits in Oxford, about the background and how we came to be doing the excavations, and then take you through from the earliest discoveries all the way through to the latest, with a little trip at the end through some of the best finds, and to wet the whistle for talks later in the year, hopefully. So, let's get down to business. Right, on the right hand side, that's an image that was taken in August this year, and that is the development area. There's the existing Westgate Centre there, and we're looking kind of northeast. There's Oxford Historic Centre just there, and the castle is just over here with the edge of the prison sticking out. That's Old Greyfriars Street going around there. The Thames over here and the Cherwell over there. And this is the development area. So this box that you see around here, that white line running along the northern edge, is this box here, and that defines the massive new basement you'll all be able to park your cars in. Double story basement, absolutely massive hole they've excavated, and to the north of that is the area of the principal Greyfriars buildings, which won't be basemented. So the impact on the archaeology of this particular development has been slightly mitigated already at the design stage, in that this area up here will be mainly left in situ after our excavations, etc. But this area here will be entirely excavated down to the Oxford clays, which is below any archaeological levels that I tend to be interested in. So that's orientated us. We're on the south west corner of Oxford city centre and the historic core. And I'll just give you some indication of that as a topographic setting. So we're looking north here, and the historic core of Oxford is at the end of the promontory, just here. Our site is just about sitting here. So you see it's sat right on the edge of the promontory as it comes down into the valley that's formed by the Thames meeting the Cherwell. And you can see how flat this ground is around here. And we all know, those of you who live on Abingdon Road, etc., and other areas that are flood, that this area is very prone to flooding, and without the sort of controls that are on our modern rivers, the flooding would be a lot worse. And this would be a promontory that really offers a nice, dry, sheltered place to settle. And there's a shot, I think, from the summer of 2007, I believe, which, if you remember it, was outrageously wet. So that just gives some indication that even in modern times, flooding can come all the way up to this area here. So historic core here, this high area is where the castle, the Norman castle, was situated, and then the Saxon burr, built around 900, concentrated on this side and probably expanded to the east this way. You can see the logical place for a crossing is where this promontory comes out and meets this promontory. That's where Morden Bridge is. And then you can see there's humps and bumps in the valley floor here that were all joined up to form a crossing across from the south up to the north. And that north-south route started its life probably in the prehistoric period has been used ever since. So what do we know about the area? So it's topographically, It's nicely situated. You can live there quite nicely. You've got the resources of the river right next to you. You've got access on across the rivers at narrow points. You can go north into the northern lands up here. A little bit problematic coming south, but good connections and good resources. So highly likely to be a place where there's going to be not only medieval archaeology, because we know we're in a medieval town, but potentially earlier archaeology as well. Let's just look at the historic maps. Of course, historic maps are post-medieval in date, and they really do kind of give you the false impression that the development area hasn't got a lot going on in it until really St. Ebbs is built in the 19th century here, 1830s onwards. You can see it all fills up. The earliest maps here, 1578 of Agas, it looks pretty empty. You can see that there's a number of waterways travelling through, and that's draining that low-lying ground away from the high ground here. Remember, the castle's up on that high promontory on the southwest corner. But there's not a lot going on in here. That is what we call the Trillmill Stream. And you can see there's some sort of border to these. Maybe that doesn't look too natural there. And it's opposite a single building that is connected with these what look like walls. And when you see the map in detail, they are indeed walls. And things don't really change in this area through the period. So 1644, the map for the Civil War defences. Really, it's a map just to show the defences. It's got the main churches on the main roads. Still fairly empty. 1675, you can see there's some market gardens developing down here. And perhaps there's the hint of a couple of buildings, and those walls seem to still exist. And then going on, 1750, there's a street now developed here and further buildings. And then in the 1900s and the modern period here with the car parks. So the historic maps really don't suggest that a lot would be on the site, but it isn't a snapshot of the medieval period, and we know in the dissolution a lot of things changed in the landscape, although the historic core of the town would probably look much the same as it had in 1578, at the start of 1500 maybe. The dissolution has really removed some of the major religious institutions, and that's exactly the structures that we have sitting in this area. And we know that because of the excavations that were conducted in the 1960s and early 70s by Tom Hassel in this area, and from some documentary research and work that was done by Salter in previous to that. So although the remains weren't known of to be on the site or survived from Salter's work, the general area was known to be the area that was settled by the Grey Friars, and all these tenements that you see up here have got some sort of listing from medieval deeds or early post-medieval deeds that Salter worked on. So some sort of reconstruction of the medieval appearance of St. Ebbs could be deduced, with the castle Barbican being documented in the 1215 construction phase. Its position not exactly known, but in the 60s and early 70s, when they built the first Westgate Centre here, serious amount of excavation work was conducted over a number of years, some on the tenements up here, but also focused on the principal church of the Grey Friars, where there are open area excavations that found that there were about six phases of church development, starting as a simple rectangular building. And then some strip trenches were put across this area, and this outline was proposed for what was to the south of the Grey Friars complex, with a quadrangle and other buildings coming off down towards the Trillmill Stream. documentary evidence suggested there was an area called the Paradise over to the west of that. So excavation work and documentary deeds suggest that in the area we've got dense inner town development here, and then right on the edge of town, in with the wall coming around here, a break in the wall was allowed and the church was put in, and an area outside that had been empty was then developed by the Greyfriars for their complex. So that kind of sets the scene for us, and we go on into our phase of works, if you like. So the car park was built, and although it was hailed as a wonderful structure at the time, probably not by all, but definitely in the by the council, it hasn't really, or didn't really stand the test of time, did it? Let's face it. And it was a bit of an eyesore. So you had big open area car parking here, buildings that have been knocked down next to the river here, a prime area for redevelopment if you ever saw one. And the back end of the Westgate looking pretty ugly as it joined on with those horrible bridges over on Greyfriars Street there. Strip trenches that Tom Hassel put across here suggested an outline of structures here. So the church is located about here, and in fact that line there is probably roughly on the south line of the church. So that's to orientate yourselves. And the church was put into the medieval defensive wall, 13th century defensive wall, which goes off round that way to meet up with Castle Tower. It's just outside this building. So our task was to basically, the proposal came in 2005, I believe, to planning to redevelop this. And the first thing that we would have to do is go in and do some evaluation work to see if the construction of the multi-storey car park had really affected the remains that Tom first discovered in the early 70s. And if they were there, then we would need to make some sort of proposal on what to do and how to deal with them during the development. And then again, an area that wasn't really focused on in that period of excavation is the valley floor, but since has become quite an interesting field of study, and some more evaluation trenches were put in here. And there were two phases of work conducted, 2006 and in 2008. The results from 2006 weren't considered to be, if you like, comprehensive enough to devise a good strategy, so extra excavation work was done in 2008 to augment the results from 2006. So you've got a ground truth, basically, whether the archaeology's there before you go and propose to spend, you know, £1 million of the developer's money excavating. So here we are in the evaluation. Oh, remember those columns? Yeah, remember that nice open car park? So you can see the archaeology is at some depth. These are shored holes. That's about four and a half metres off the level of the car park, and there you can see we're finding very large non-oak timbers, part of some sort of structure, and in the bottom of there you can see a wall at the back. That's underneath the multi-storey car park. So we found that indeed decent archaeology in terms of timber structures and stone walls still survived the construction of the multi-storey, and were still in the ground and needed to have some sort of strategy to deal with them during the redevelopment phase. Now, the kind of bottom fell out of the financial markets around the same time, and I think we were just up at Dan Paul will remember this because he was in charge of these evaluation works, my colleague, and we were just about to go on site and start doing some excavation works for the previous scheme when the bottom fell out of the financial markets and the whole thing got shelved and the developer disappeared. And it's taken, what, another 7 years, 8 years for somebody to come back in and pick it up again, and that's where we came back in. So all the work that we did back then and all the work that Tom did in the 60s and 70s are all now feeding into the work and the strategy that we're working to now. So let's just have a little look at what we found during the evaluation phase. So this yellow area is the high ground, so you can see high ground up here falling away down into the lower ground, and that reflects what we know about the topography of Oxford. But here you can see a dark blue band coming through. That's what we call, that's a lower area, and that's where the Trill Mill stream, that historic stream that we saw on the maps coming around the south end of the Friary complex, that is the earliest prehistoric hint of that channel there. This is a map of the gravel surface, and some of that gravel is up to 6-7 metres down below current ground levels. So in this area here, you can see there's a slightly higher area that indicated that there may be some sort of Iron Age settlement, potentially prehistoric settlement in the area, that's known of further to the south down the Abingdon Road. We know that we've got this edge here, and we know probably that the Trill Mill stream was not just a man-made stream, probably from the medieval period, but has some prehistoric topographic precursor to it. So that's all very interesting. This is a stylized cross-section that we did from the evaluation work. Here you can see this is the level of the Oxford clay diving away, then the gravel will follow that level as well. So this is rising up to the promontory that Oxford's built on. Here's the Trill Mill stream, and yes, indeed, we found prehistoric precursors here in yellow, and then an early, what looked like an early medieval phase, re-digging and re-calibrating that channel all the way up until the brick culvert was built in the middle of it in the 1850s to try and prevent the cholera outbreaks from 10 years previously. And you can see how the floodplain here is going off and levelling off, and that's all being filled with alluvium. And you can see how that alluvium of the filling of the floodplain is then overlain with what looks like decent archaeological levels, sealing 11th and 12th century quarrying up here. So a big long sequence, that's about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 metres worth of potential archaeology that we would have to deal with. So how do we cope with all of that information? So what we found was, to mitigate that, we had to basically divide the site up into areas that we were going to excavate in certain ways, depending on the impacts and what was there. So in these two areas here, that's where the Friary remains were, underneath the multi-storey car park and that bit of car park that ran up to it there. But that line forms the big basement. So we had a different strategy on this side from the strategy on this side. So in this side, we're trying to keep, understand the nature of the Friary, but keep as much of the remains as we can. On this side, we've got to do as much excavation and understanding as possible before it's all dug out. So the whole area gets split up into these different areas with different aims. So areas 1 and 2 here, we were looking at the Victorian period when we've got all those terrace streets from the St. Ebbs development. Area 3 and a bit over here in Area 4, we're looking at the Trill Mill stream and its history, and we know we've got a long history of use of that stream and prehistory. Area 4, the southern extent of the Grey Friars complex, the bit that's going to get completely dug away by the basement. Area 5, where they're re-diverting the stream through, and those of you who came to the open day in September walked along the top of that and then up and round there, if you remember. Area 7, the northern extent, so that's the area of the tour at that time. Area 8, the possible Iron Age settlement on that high ground. And then, because we want to understand how this valley floor is filled up, we're doing two transects. So we're doing about 130 metre long transect across here and 50 metre transect across here. And that's fully stepped trenches to look at how the floodplain has built up and how this channel has then moved through that. Then a watching brief to cover this area where we hadn't found a huge amount of remains, and then outreach, so that's what this is, talking to the public and presenting what we find to people who live in Oxford and further afield. And then we had to do, we've got to do analysis and publication, and then put all of our finds, etc., to the museum service, so that they, when they've got nice galleries after they've been some more HLF money, they can display it all. So that's where we are. That's the scheme that we worked up, and that's the scheme we have. We're delivering now. So what I want to do now is just go through, from the earliest to the latest, some of the findings that we've got, suggest some of the dates and functions for what we're looking at, and then show you some of the structures and the finds that we're getting out. So let's reorientate ourselves. So this is in area three, which was in the big double story basement, and we've just completed looking at 4 meters of archaeology above here, and then found this surface. So this is a very flat gravel surface at the base of the alluvial sequence, made up of well-sorted gravels, but with the occasional odd gravel piece in that seems non-local. Ignore those timbers, they're medieval and from a later phase. It was absolutely dead flat and metal. It appeared to be man-made, and this isn't the full extent of it. It also extended all the way out here and was cut by later channels, etc., and overlain by all these silts that filled up the valley floor. Liz Stafford, our geoarchaeologist at Oxford Archaeology, still is in two minds. Is it natural? Is it man-made? So then you start to weigh arguments up on either side of that equation. If it's natural, why aren't we observing it in other areas where we're digging down to the gravel? If it's natural, why is it forming completely flat? Why is it so compact? If it's man-made, why aren't there any finds on top of it? Why aren't there any features in it? Why aren't there any cart ruts in it? If this is a potential ford, if you like, across soft ground, across that valley floor that we know is there, why aren't there any cart ruts? Are there any things that look similar to it? Well, in the east of England, in the Middle Bronze Age, and this is Middle Bronze Age or earlier, based on carbon 14 dating from organic silts on the surface, they have similar surfaces over there from the Middle Bronze Age. So it could be, but they've got cart ruts and finds on top of them. So we've taken a lot of soil samples. These are all tags where we've taken samples, etc., to try and work out whether this was man-made or not. And that, of course, is all for the analysis stage, and we won't be starting that until we finish those excavations. So an enigmatic surface and an enigmatic puzzle. Perhaps one of the earliest fords across from south to north up onto the high ground that's been found so far. And that surface is down there. That's the surface going off back there, and this is all the alluvial sequence above it that we've had to step through. There it is there, that's the surface that they're standing on. You can see how flat it is. And then these organic silts here, those are the silts that we dated to the Middle Bronze Age. That shows us that plants were growing on that surface, and in fact, the only thing in that surface was root disturbance from plants of that period. And that it's gone black because the water has risen and been consistently high enough and above that level enough to then create a sort of semi-peat, an organic silt that's formed there. And as the water has increased over this area, no more plants have grown, and that slow-moving water has deposited all these silts. And that is what's raised that valley floor up. So from the Middle Bronze Age, from about 1,000-1,500 BC onwards, so 3 to 3,500 years, broadly speaking, those about 3 metres of alluvial silts have built up, and then all the archaeology that I'm going to be talking about is cut then down through those silts again, and that is the major effect on this landscape here, that filling and levelling out of the valley floor stretching all the way back here. We're taking samples through that so we can tell what sort of plant matter was around in the Middle Bronze Age in that area and what sort of formation processes there were through all these silts, and that transect was continued all the way to the south, right to the edge of the excavation. As I say, no real prehistoric finds on the top. So that's our valley floor sequence. The Holocene alluviation. This, of course, is essentially soil that has been eroded from further upstream in the catchment area of the Thames. But that then sets the landscape and the scene for the historic periods, because we have to jump forward now, because we haven't really found any human activity right up until the late Saxon period. So we're going to jump all the way to the late Saxon period now. I'm just going to orientate yourselves. This is from a book we published called Oxford Before the University, and this is a stylized plan of what, based on current excavations, we think late Saxon Oxford will look like. And just to orientate yourselves, our excavations are down in this area here. So you can see here's the Thames coming round, Trill Mill Stream defining the southern extent of the historic town. Lots of question marks about where the western extent of the town is, and I think the excavations at Oxford Castle will help to contribute to solving those problems. The southern defences we know come up along here, they were found on the castle site, but can't be traced further, and that's one of the things we're going to be looking for underneath Old Grey Friars Street, so the late Saxon defences. But you can see this kind of grassy indicator here shows that this is kind of marshy land. So that's where the edge of the promontory is, probably seasonally flooding up here, but there is a gap between the defences and the edge of the channel. And that will come back in later on. So, although these features don't look like much, this is late Saxon occupation and use of this gap between the defences and the river's edge. You see, it's quite a big area, it's fairly useful. In the dry months, there's no reason why you shouldn't be using that for some sort of craft activity. And indeed, evidence for flax retting has been found on the high ground over here and further afield down in these areas here. And there's no reason to think that this area wasn't used for similar processes or other processes that needed water to be used. Other late Saxon features have been found as well, but we're not comprehensively exposing this phase of archaeological information. A lot of this has been left in the ground and we're looking at it in small pieces, so we're going to get a kind of bitty picture, but at least some indication of that sort of activity. But up until excavations at Pembroke College and these excavations, this area wasn't really known to be utilised in the late Saxon period. So outside the town defences, an area of land being used. Very interesting. This very colourful picture indicates the Trill Mill Stream to the south of that higher ground. So in the late Saxon period, you've got this higher ground area that's being utilised perhaps seasonally. To the south of that, you've got a stream, a river essentially, and you see all the banding in there. Well, that is a big latest river channel there, and an earlier river channel there. We thought that was natural gravel originally, because it looks so similar to the natural gravel which you see down at the base here. But these are high energy gravel deposits in historic period channels. So these channels were flowing with a very high energy, fast moving water that can carry stones of this sort of size. At the time, the late Saxon use of that area between the defences and the river. But you can see that they're filling up and shifting around. Both of these channels are of probably late Saxon, early medieval date. And I think I've got the slide in. They're flowing so quickly that they're washing dead oxen, or perhaps live oxen that then become dead, down through those gravels. And we found at least the remains of another two of these. And this was a very popular with the kids on the first open day. We thought it was natural, and we thought it was prehistoric, potentially, but it's not. It's historic, and it's happening while the late Saxon and early medieval occupation of the town up here. But you can see that it's filling up. The channel is filling up and filling up and filling up. And at the top here, the water is starting to slow down, and it's depositing silts that are forming these alluvials. And then that would be fairly marshy, boggy ground. So the river channels are getting less influential on this edge and becoming slower moving, and perhaps moving to the south somewhere we haven't found them yet, or being re-diverted and engineered in some sort of way by the Normans. And then the Greyfriars, which we'll go on to talk about, are then reclaiming this area. So you've got this silty, boggy area here, which is then getting reclaimed. And this is all soils that have been brought in and dumped for the construction of these medieval walls that are to do with the Greyfriars. So that sequence there is probably about 6-7 metres of archaeology, all rather exciting and colourful. So let's talk about the Greyfriars. So this brown area here, brown and brown lines, that was the suggested outline after Tom Hassell's excavations in the 60s and 70s. What's underneath is then what we found, and you can see that there is a good level of agreement between the two, but because at that time there was only the opportunity to do these narrow trenches, some of the walls weren't discovered and some of the trenches didn't go far enough into the area to discover a lot more of the buildings. So in fact, some of the projected lines of the walls are incorrect, or buildings are slightly over to one side, and there are in fact almost double the amount of buildings that was first thought in this area. And there is some phasing associated with this channel as well. So this is our current plan. There is some phasing associated with it. There is some changes that we've made, but I wasn't feeling brave enough to bring them to the public at the moment. But this is broadly what we think is going on. So there's the church, there's the cloister here, the main cloister, and then to the south of that, that's the southern range of the main cloister, just across there. And then it looks like we've got a lower cloister or minor cloister associated immediately to the south. And if you see the line of this wall, it's dead straight, all the way up here, dead straight, all the way up. And perpendicular to the southern wall of the church. And that was all single build. All seem to be built in the same manner. So my assumption on that is when the Greyfriars got permission to knock this hole in the city defences, build their church and extend their complexes into this area that hadn't had much occupation going on, but perhaps some, that the first phase of church and this wall are all pretty much contemporary, and suggesting that in its original layout, you've got main cloister to the north and minor cloister to the south. What also seems contemporary with that is this water channel, at least this, not that hump there, but this phase here coming through, and this bypass coming through here. Probably this very large precinct wall as well, which is extending northwards to reconnect with the city wall up here, and extending eastwards here to reconnect with Littlegate Street over here, and possibly back up to the gateway off Littlegate Street, which is over to the east of there. Permission was given to take that element out of the wall, but they were asked, and the documentary evidence suggests they were asked, that they rebuild a crenellated wall after, but there was no documentation in, say, their building accounts, for example, that that ever happened. So finding this exceptionally large wall was a real bonus, and it looks like they've taken that part of the agreement quite seriously, because this wall is almost twice as wide as any of the other walls on these buildings. The other thing to note here is some of the buildings have these buttresses, so conceived in Gothic style, I would have thought, with nice windows in between the buttresses. This building as well here, but this building not. No buttresses on this building. I think these are the fancy, nice buildings, and you'll see later on how that building is probably the kitchen and service structures. This kink in the channel here, is that kink is later because they inserted this large structure here. So that is a later building, and possibly that is a later building as well. So the original phase is here. As the friary gets more successful, it attracts more international students. It was a Studium Generale. It had a very good international reputation. It had maybe 60 to 70 to 80 of its own friars living and working within it. Also then inviting and getting students from all over Europe to come and visit as well. There's a lot of people to house, and there would have been a heyday, and adding these buildings on, we know that the church itself has got, this is added on here, this is added on here. Each phase adds on more capacity, and I'd be very surprised if after analysis we don't find a similar development here. Of course, we're missing this part as well of the precinct, which would have had plenty of buildings in it probably too. So looking down from our drone, because we're modern too.
Have you got a licence for it?
We've got a licence, yes. Yes, we have. We've got a licence, and the British Airports Authority know what we do. Honest stuff.
Right.
Yeah, and we pay the council to fly as well off their property.
We're a long way from the flight path.
We are, except for the spy plane, of course. Yeah. So there's the precinct wall coming round there. Big fat wall. Here's that later building with its buttresses. Here's the water channel coming in here and going out there. There's the cloister at the back, what would have been the church, which is now the rather attractive back end of Westgate, which they're going to start demolishing in about 10 days' time. There's the kitchen block there. And this is the Trill Mill stream running through here, and this is what we're calling the mill site, but it might not be. So we're just going to look at some details of that. So just looking at the quality of the build of that precinct wall, these are all from the southern area of the walkway. So the area that everybody walked round in September was up here. This is coming to the south, so this is in the area that's being built up that would have been the river, but then becomes a slow moving silt filled area. You can see some of those silts building up there, and the way they've coped with that soft ground in this particular location is to put round gravel in the base before they put their stone in, and that's not the case everywhere. There is a lot of timber work underneath that wall as well, and we'll see a bit of that in a minute. And this is the finest bit of wall. So this is sitting right to the south of the lower cloister and the adjacent building. And it looks like it's built well enough, and this is actually contemporary to this. This is just the facing, but it is contemporary. It looks like that could have been some sort of wharfage, so a place that boats could come up, potentially small inland craft could come up and then unload potentially in this area. There's no other reason I can think to have that nice bit of wall there, especially if it's, as I think it is, it's contemporary. So
dating?
Dating. Dating will rely a lot upon these dark sticks. Underneath the wall, to deal with the soft ground, where they didn't put Rand's gravel, we found, at the moment, we've excavated 2,000 timbers on the site. And when that tour happened in September, we found about 10 in total. So we've done a serious amount of timber since then. Here is the corner of the precinct wall, and it's just a forest of timbers with these stones dropped down in between them to make a good, stable, solid corner to resist the undermining effect of the stream as it's coming up. But you'll see some of them are brown looking and some of them are dark black looking. The dark black ones are oak and the browner ones are probably beech and elm. Beech and elm are quite difficult to date. And the issue about the oak is they're mainly from reused buildings. So the friars have got hold of some building that's been knocked down somewhere, or one of their buildings even, one of their earlier buildings, and reused all the timber work. So in fact here we've got this wonderful example of a bit of timber framing that's actually still jointed, but they've just taken out of the building and then just plonked it in there. I mean, that must have been more difficult than hacking that off with an axe and just putting that in. In this area here, that's a pier base for a relieving arches. That had 160 beech branches used, and they're just the offcuts from the main tree. Some of the nicest reused timbers that we got were these octagonal shafts, these posts. If we look carefully at the ends here, you can see these come up to a squared end, and this comes to a circular end here, but all of them have these long shafts opposing, one on this side, one on that side, on each one. They're octagonal, so they're designed to be viewed all the way around, and the shafts would have jointed into other timbers. And one of the suggestions that we came up with is that this could have formed some form of screen, perhaps even the rood screen, in one phase of the church. So maybe between, we know that the church has 6 phases, we also know that they had an earlier church. And if this is part of the original build of the precinct wall, and it goes with the 1240s build of the original part of the church, and that alignment of the main quad and the lower cloister, then this could be from the earliest church, even. There's no way of proving that, but it seems the structure that it would come from is a screen of some sort, I would imagine. Whether it comes from that church is another thing. These are going to be saved by the museum and for display at some later point. So, just to remind you, let me see where I'm going now. I've slightly lost my thread. Ah, yes. So, those timbers were under there. We were looking at the construction of this wall under here. And that's where the majority of the timbers have come from, underneath that area. That timber frame was just from here. Those posts were from here, and it was built in little groups. So what we've done is group the timbers together with the hope that if we look at a group, say a big group here or a big group from here, that are distinct, we can say potentially you come from one building that's been knocked down and you all belong together. So we could possibly try and refit them to see what the nature of the timber framing was that those timbers then came from. In terms of dating, of course, it leaves us with the conundrum that we're going to be dating earlier phase buildings, but I would imagine at some point we're going to be able to narrow it down. It's going to be later than a certain date. And because these walls are associated with lots of dumped material to raise the ground up, we're also going to get a date from that. that. So combining all those dates together, we should be able to refine this fairly accurately. And there may even be some oak that's been cut specifically for use in these piles, but because we're having to work through it so quickly at the moment, we don't know. So we've got to wait for analysis, I'm afraid. So just a few details of some of the other structures. So we're going to look here at just some of the really nice details that we've got. So this is the, what I'm thinking is the refectory building. So that's the building that's added on to the southwest corner, which the channel has to kink round. And you can see the nice stonework that's used on the southern buttress there. There's another buttress, Gothic architecture. There's a relieving arch. So there's the full arch there, and that's the relieving arch pier base where the 140-odd beach piles came out of.
Sorry, what's a relieving arch?
It's an architectural kind of way of dealing with the forces. So if you're building in soft ground, you can either pile under the whole of the wall, or you can have it springing. The weight that's on the top of the arch is going out to the sides, just like over a window or a door, but it's underground and you can't see it. And there's quite a few examples of that in Oxford, some in the actual defences of Oxford as well. Because when these buildings are built, not only in this situation you've got soft ground because it was a river, but in other areas you've got soft ground because somebody else has dug a hole there and it's filled up with soft dirt. And the builders who are building the new building will come along, find that bit of soft ground and go, I'm not digging down there and filling it with stone, I'm just gonna spring over it. Yeah. Exactly. And of course the buttresses here would have been very keen architectural features to support these walls in such soft ground as well. And I have to tell you, the mortar in this element of the wall was so strong that we had to use a breaker on a machine to break it out. I think the next strongest mortar you don't get to the 18th century, and of course prior to that it was the Romans, so I've never seen medieval mortar that strong. Just some other nice details here. This is the stone-lined water channel. And this was great. I mean, it's a friary site. There weren't many rubbish pits. I spend my life doing medieval sites in towns, and it's just one rubbish pit after another. They're quite interesting, what's in them. But you do get a bit, you just long for something else, really. This water channel was brilliant, because not only was it filled with wonderful rubbish, but it wasn't as complicated as digging loads of intercutting medieval pits. And the end result was something pleasing to look at as well. So southern cloister had the rear daughter in it, which was the wash block and toilet block for the friary. And this is the ashlar blockwork that's flushing their toilet block out. So that's at the end of the channel. It then flushes all the waste from that block out back into the river and down to the Blackfriars. This is who were their neighbours to the east. This is the bypass channel here, and the bypass channel had this sluice gate arrangement set in it so that they could control the flow of water through. So the sluice gate would shut water off from the bypass and allow it to flow through the toilet block. Now, so the sluice gate is just here. There's the toilet block and rear daughter. You see the nice stonework going through there. That's at the end, so it's being flushed out. It went then in the timber pipe and out back into the Trillmill stream. And there's the bypass there. So when there's not enough flow of water, that can get shut off and all the water can be flushed through there. So the Oxford Museum is also keeping this as an element as well, which is quite nice. But just to see the wonderful stonework and the flooring there, I mean, you could, you know, it was just really very, very well preserved. And what was inside it was also very well preserved, because the high water table, because of where we are, in that valley floor. The high water table allowed preservation of lots of amazing organic remains of leather and wood, and we'll see some of those in a minute. But I just wanted to show you some of the floors from the buildings. The function of the rooms is quite hard to of the buildings is quite hard to determine, and we're going to have to look at the way other friaries organised and what function the rooms, the buildings are there. But one, because we didn't have many floors, even if we had had the floors, they probably would have only had flagstone floors and tile floors. It would still be very difficult to determine what those buildings were used for. But one that wasn't that difficult to determine was the kitchen, because of the nature of what kitchens look like. Now, you'll notice there's no buttresses on the outside walls to the kitchen, because it's a very functional structure. It's not going to have nice big Gothic windows in it. It's going to have little windows at the top, probably a fairly plain-looking wall, and be quite a nasty dark place, hot and dark place to work. There's two very large keyhole hearths set down here, which is at the southern end of it, with a servery probably beyond that, and a buttery. And you can see that the floor is absolutely thick with this, the sweeping out of the hearths as they get. This is 300 years of use of this kitchen. If it's primary, if it's later, we'll be able to get some C14 dating on all the nice charred plant remains that are surviving there. And those remains will also tell us about the diet. So we'll get in situ remains, we'll work out what they're eating and cooking from these particular ovens and hearths. And also in the kitchen yard area, we had a lot of these very large pits, and each one of these dark layers is some of this material that's been swept out and then thrown away in these pits. So we're going to get a very, very good idea of the diet of the friars, not only broadly speaking of a friary, say, compared to somewhere else, but from the early diet through to the later diet, because this is all stratified remains, so we'll be able to see if their diet gets better over time. And of course, just wonderful, nice oven structures as well, rebuilt over a number of phases with this skirting outside of it, this working area here. Moving on, just to reacquaint ourselves, look, there's the kitchen there with the ovens, and that's set off to this side. The kitchen yard was here. There would have been a gateway through this wall, but not the level that we excavated, out into paradise, which was where they were would have had their fruit and vegetable gardens and kept their pigs, etc., and geese in this area out here. So It's a very logical place for the kitchen to be. And adjacent in this channel here, we found a load of very plain iron knives, and that is suggesting to me that this later building was the refectory or eating hall, and that would make that there's a nice logic to having the eating hall near to the kitchen. Although there was probably another kitchen somewhere over here, and possibly another eating hall as well, because there's an eating hall for the guests, as well as much as there is probably for those that were living on site. Other structures that we might encounter when we do this area up here are the libraries. Of course, the Grey Friars in Oxford were famous for having two libraries. The chapter house, which is usually on this eastern side of the main cloister, the sacristy, and other assorted buildings. There would have probably been some dormitory space up here as well. So what I want to spin over and talk about a little bit now is this area over here, which we're still working on the plans for. This is the what we're calling the mill site. Well, I might just call it Area 6. There's no interpretation in that. But if we imagine the Trill Mill stream is flowing through here, from this direction over to this direction, this water channel's flowing like that and down like that. This is two channels. There's one here and there's one here. And these brown are timber beams. and the grey is the stonework. So we're just going to have a little look at those structures. This is the medieval phase. Much of the medieval phase that I'm assuming was there has been destroyed and removed by the post-medieval phase, but those bits that survived will help us piece together what was there at that phase. And they don't look to be in places that are dissimilar from the later phases. So by that I mean, where they established channels in the medieval period and possibly structures is where they were then rebuilt later on, possibly in the early post-medieval phase, maybe Tudor around that phase, or possibly even later. So what we've got here is, this is a base plate frame construction that's taking a water channel through a sluice. So where it narrows here, this pinch point is where the sluice gates would have been, and a structure much like the sluice in the stone channel would be, receiving gates up and down to let that allow water in and out, channeling in. These vacant waterses here would have taken uprights, and then behind the uprights would be planking, and that would make a retaining wall. So this would be a timber channel. So this is a timber channel as opposed to the stone channels that we saw on the other side over here associated with the friary. A much more simple structure here is simple post and plank revetment, probably of the same phase. You see this is all in dark oak wood here. These planks, some of the widest medieval planks I've seen, some of them are about 800 mil wide, deep if you like, and that thick, all hand sawn. And surviving. The reason I haven't explained this, but the reason that we can excavate all of this is because you see this steel wall that the builders put in, that's sealed off a big area where the car park's going to be, and they've pumped all the water out. Usually when we excavate this sort of thing, we're slopping around in mud and having a right old time of it. But luckily they've pumped all the water out, so we can do all these wonderfully preserved structures without all the hassle of having to do all the pumping ourselves and get all overly muddy. Not that we don't get muddy. The later phase of replacement of that, so that structure that you saw in wood was replaced in stone at a later point, but you can see it's exactly the same structure. It's got this pinch point here. You can see the slots where the sluice gates were, and it's widening, so it's being narrowed in and then widening out on the other side. And this stonework is very similar in look to this stonework here. The medieval post and plank revetment is behind here, and this is a later phase. So this later phase has chopped away all the potentially other medieval remains that would have been in this area to install this big channel in here. This is acting as a kind of weir, so the water is coming down the trill mill stream here, but it's being allowed to come over this boarding into this channel and feeding a structure back in here. And there's the edge of the channel, the stone skirt just there, with a series of timber beams. Do you remember from the evaluation, right at the start of the talk, there was a chap down a hole 4 metres deep, I said, and there's those timbers. So those timbers that we found in that evaluation hole are those timbers there, and part of a much bigger structure. We've got vacant joints here and slots in the wood here where there would have been superstructure just after that channel. And then hundreds, literally hundreds of posts retaining the edges, the two edges, as they're going back, and we're going to be extending the excavations back there. But really, really monumental archaeology coming out here, possibly Tudor in date. Reused structures here with amazing jointing and just wonderful details of carpentry work that we can get from studying these. These are all being hand-drawn to scale and sampled, hopefully to get a date on when these structures were. But reused from somewhere else, you can see how it's all been chopped down just to reinstate here. size of some of these stones as well. And when you see, say you go around the, where the Castle Mill stream is, around the corner from here, you'll see exactly this period of walling down on the edge of the channel as it goes under the bridge. Exactly that phase.
Is a stone local stone?
We've got to study the stone, but yes, I would. Yes, there's local quarries, all of the stones, local quarries. Just jumping forward a little bit further, this is the Civil War, so we've kind of dealt with the medieval, we've dealt with what we think is the kind of Tudor a phase of redevelopment of the possible mill site. The other interpretation of that is it's some sort of fisheries.
That's what I remember.
Yeah, exactly. So they would have had fish ponds somewhere. And you've got to be able to control the water into those fish ponds. Yeah. And they were quite elaborate places like Wardsley Abbey. You had all sorts of elaborate sluice gating.
Looking at it, that's what it looked like.
Yeah, and the odd thing was that either side of those post and plank things, there weren't actually foundations for a building on the bank, which I found quite odd. So maybe it's just the sluice housing, or even they would have had some sort of fishing nets or
the catch on the
exactly. So we know that here we've got de Gaulle's plan, and these defences run through our area. On some of the plans they're actually dotted, but on this one it's solid. And we thought, hopefully we're going to pick that up, and we did. That's the Civil War ditch there, and immediately adjacent to that we found this wonderful halberd, which is on display at the 40 objects for 40 years at the Museum of Oxford, and will be on display in a later exhibition I'll talk about. Excuse me. There's the halberd there in those wonderful contemporary cuts. We also know that there was a tannery later on, just after the Civil War, probably 18th century going into the 19th century, prior to St. Ebbs being built. There was a lot of tanning going on. Of course, you need a lot of water to do tanning. And one thing I didn't tell you was, prior to the friary being constructed, there was one, we found one large stone building with a massive pit next to it, and there's a lot of offcuts of leather coming out. So prior to the 1240s, when the friary gets constructed, there is one building on there with all this leather, and perhaps that is pre-friary use tanning in that area, not late Saxon, but post-conquest, and this use comes back into that area in the post-medieval period. And that's the horn cause, so that the skins would be delivered with their heads on and they'd have to chop the horns off, and that's the waste from the tanning. Now I'm going to show you a few nice objects. In the foundations of some of the later buildings, not only did we find reused wood, we found bits of earlier building and bits of earlier stone objects as well. So here's a very nice Romanesque piece of architecture, probably from the doorway. But it's not very eroded, so it looks like it's been sheltered from the wind and the rain, but it's probably from the doorway. You've got a half semicircular arch coming off there, and this wonderful decoration. That's the only piece we found, unfortunately. This is probably some sort of food press. It's massive, it's about that diameter. It's probably, I think our stone, our specialist in querns says it's one of the biggest that she's seen from the UK, and has parallels on the continent for wine pressing, for pressing grapes. So that was reused in the foundation as well. I mean, if you want to get rid of something like that, you might as well write it up and put it in the foundation if you're not going to use it again. But that's a really nice object. And there's the spout just there. Of course, the friary, it's a religious place for education. So we've got wonderful objects that show both the religious side of things, such as this Thomas a Becket pilgrim's badge made out of pewter. We've got to get it cleaned up. This was only just found, but there's Thomas a Becket down there being stabbed. And there's from the library, here's a book clasp. So that would be clipping the end of the book to keep the pages together with a nice letter, Gothic letter M on there. Very nice object. And then a parchment pricker here for pricking past parchment so you can put a horizontal line between and to write on. And a stylus with either gold or some sort of copper alloy plating. I'd like to think it was gold. yeah, it does look. Yeah, but the copper alloy looks like that. When you bring it out of waterlogged sites, copper alloy looks very gold-like. Yeah. In fact, gold looks duller.
which is, I'll remember that.
Yeah. just some wonderful wooden objects as well. I'm gonna ask you a question in a minute. This is a really nice, delicate, turned bowl, maybe just as big as the palm. Oh, I can hold it in my hand like that. That's a sluice gate. So that's one of the gates that would have sat in one of those sluice arrangements. And it's like a Paddle and Rhymer gate now. You know, they're replacing them. The environment agency are replacing them all. But it used to be able to just go and lift them up or wind them up. And can anybody tell me, guess what that is? Anybody? It's a fingerless fretboard. Musical instrument. So you can. It's probably made out of some sort of fruit wood, and it's really nice to find objects that are not just the mundane or the structural, but you know, for musical instruments. So obviously from carvings and from pictures from the period, you know that musical instruments were being used. But to find them. You know, objects like that, to be able to if you gave that to a musical instrument historian to reconstruct, that would be a very interesting find to study. Just some other wonderful objects as well. Leather bags, that's a nice leather shoulder bag, and a nice leather money purse as well. The metalwork, the coinage, there's a short cross gold coin there. You've got to clean it up to find out exactly who that is, but it's definitely medieval, and I would imagine it's Edward II potentially. A small lead weight, perhaps for holding down pages when you're reading books, but many other functions. A buckle, a nice pendant with this floral design on it, made out of probably some sort of ivory, maybe marine ivory. Later shoes, this is probably from the 19th century, but still the preservation's excellent, and a really nice find. We've got all sorts of other wonderful things from the 19th century, including this pistol, which it's probably a toy pistol, but you know, the imagination ran wild when we found it. And that takes me on to a little bit of work that we did in areas 1 and 2, right back in January and February this time last year we started this work. There's the multi-storey car park still standing. We opened up these small trenches to try and find the foundations to some of these terraced streets. We found the foundations to those. The ground's been raised up out of that damp area. There was clay packed in round the foundations here to try and stop the damp rising up into the walls. Cheek by jowl, tenements, very narrow streets, and we got to open 2 areas. We were mainly trying to find out whether the waste pits were next, the toilet, the latrines, because it wasn't running water. There were latrine holes next to wells. And there's a cholera outbreak. Great system. Cholera outbreak in the 1840s, and after that, the Board of Health quickly decided that perhaps, you know, that wasn't such a good idea, and they should pipe water in and pipe waste out. And that's when the Trillmill Stream finally got enclosed into a brick pipe because it was just being used as a place to dump waste and of all types. So that was our work on that. This is just some of the outreach we've been doing. That was that wonderful day in September. We had such good weather. We had the modern friars from the modern Grey Friars community came to visit.
Oh, good.
And didn't dig them up then.
No, that still might come. We might. They're standing in the kitchen, which I thought was a suitable place to stand, especially this chap here. He was one. They were very interested. It was really nice to have them along, actually. And some school visits that we had as well. And we've got a viewing area down on Norfolk Street. So it's not a route that you would choose unless you were parked at Oxpens, but if you want to have a look in the hole, there's not a lot of archaeology to see now, but it's still quite interesting. We've got all our posters up down there. It's just on the left as you go down Norfolk Street. And just to say that we realised that the open days, there's a huge amount of demand for the open days.
Yeah.
We were oversubscribed on the second one, and lots of people asked us to have another open day, and it's just impossible because of the nature of where we're digging now, the speed at which the developer is asking the builder to put the building up. The opportunity just isn't there. But we also had 2,000 people through our pop-up museum, which we put in the Westgate Centre, and we thought the best way to try and find a happy medium between not being able to open the site and having only this pop-up museum open for 6 weeks last June and July was to try and find opportunities to have another exhibition. And we made a lot of friends while we were doing this. Becky was absolutely brilliant. My colleague Becky was working on all the outreach and made a lot of friends with a lot of people and was able to basically get some free space in the gallery at the museum. So we're now working on choosing some of the best finds, some of the best pictures to put on display there, and we'll be opening 4th of March to the 29th of April. And please tell people, there'll be plenty of press about it. I'm going to call it Westgate Oxford, the story so far, because it will just be a work in progress, much like tonight's talk has been. And I think I've come to the end of my talk. Thank you very much.